So the next topic that we are going to take is speed control of DC motor. So you are you have performed this in the lab, the speed control of DC motor, and you know that there are two different methods of speed control. One is armature control and another is field control. So that we are going to discuss. So let us see. So in order to understand the speed control method, you have to remember this particular equation, the characteristic equations, that is, the speed is proportional to back EMF by flux, and back EMF can be written as V minus IARA from the KVL equation for a DC motor, and this relationship will be helpful to understand the speed control of a DC motor. That is, the speed is proportional to voltage minus IARA, that is the drop across the armature, divided by the flux. So this relationship is important to understand the speed control. So here you have how you can control the speed. So you can control the speed by controlling the armature resistance. So you can control the speed by controlling the armature resistance, that is the first method, which is known as the armature resistance or rheostatic control. You can control the speed by varying the flux. So that is the second method. So this method is known as the field flux control. So these two methods are generally used for controlling the speed of a DC motor. There is one more method, that is the third method, which is rarely used, and it is used in industries alone, where you, for the big DC motors, by controlling this applied voltage. So by controlling this applied voltage, you can also control the speed of the DC motors. So this is generally used in large industrial applications that we are going to see. So basically, our focus of discussion will be on these two particular methods. One is known as the armature resistance or rheostatic control. Second is known as field flux control. Now let us see. So the first method we will be focusing on armature resistance control, and our motor that we have taken is shunt motor. So you know that in shunt motor, your field winding is connected in parallel with the armature. So this is your armature and this is your field winding, which is connected in parallel, and this is your armature resistance. So you have connected a rheostat. So this is your rheostat, which you have connected in series with the armature, and you know that you can vary the resistance of the rheostat with this moving contact. So you have a fixed contact and a moving contact. So by varying the moving contact, sliding it, you can control the armature resistance, you can control the resistance. So by varying this rheostat, what will happen? The resistance will increase or decrease, and you can control the armature current. So you can easily control the armature current by controlling the resistance of the rheostat. So the variation in the variable resistance does not affect the flux, as the field is directly connected to the supply mains. So this one thing you have to understand, that in this case, the field, whatever the field is there, it is directly connected with the supply mains. So even you are changing this rheostat, it will not change the flux. So flux, as it is connected directly to the supply mains, so it will not be varied or not be affected by changing the rheostat. So if you see the speed armature current characteristic, then you know that for a shunt motor, your characteristic under the normal condition is this one. So this is your normal characteristic under the shunt motor. Now what happened is that by controlling, with the help of controlling the armature current with the change in the resistance, you can we can decrease the speed with the help of a series resistor. So with the help of a series resistor, your characteristic will fall from the normal condition. because speed is proportional to V minus IARA, that is the drop divided by flux. So this flux you can remove because it is a shunt motor. So keeping this voltage constant, you can change the armature current by varying this rheostat. So once you vary the rheostat, your armature current will change, then your speed will change. So speed will fall from the condition, from the normal condition. Okay. So now focus your discussion on series motor. So series motor, your field winding is connected in series with armature. So this is your armature and your field winding is connected. Now you are having a rheostat which is connected in series with the armature. So this is your armature resistance. So what is happening now? First point, by varying the armature resistance, so by changing this rheostatic position, actually the total resistance of this, the sum of the rheostatic resistance plus RA, that is the total armature resistance, will vary, and the current and flux both are affected. So if you remember, in the shunt motor your flux is not affected, but here your flux will be affected because your flux is controlled with the help of the armature current, which is in series with the armature. So the current and flux both are affected. So the voltage drop in the variable resistance increases to the armature. So once you vary the armature current, so what will happen? The drop, that is the drop across the rheostat, will also be there, and as a result the speed will fall. Again, if you understand from the relation, speed is proportional to V minus IARA by flux. So here your flux is proportional to armature current. So what is happening? This voltage is constant. You do not change the voltage, it is keeping constant. Now for a series motor, when you are changing the rheostat, your armature current is changing in such a way that the speed is falling, because the drop will also fall. So when you increase the resistance of the rheostat, the motor runs at the lower speed. So if you remember the characteristic of the speed versus armature current, then the normal condition, it is in the falling stage like this, and with a series resistor the speed will further fall. So since the variable resistance carries the full armature current, it must be designed to carry continuously the full armature current. Now what is the meaning of this? The rheostat which is you are connecting is carrying the entire amount of the armature current. So it has to be properly designed so that it can bear the maximum full load armature current. So here also your speed is falling with the help of controlling the armature resistance. Now there are certain disadvantages of armature resistance control method. So what are the disadvantages? First disadvantage is that a large amount of power is wasted in the external resistance. So there is a rheostat which is connected in series with armature. So this rheostat is controlling falling a large amount of power drop. So there is a lot of power wastage. Second is restricted to keep the speed below the normal speed. So if you remember the characteristic, it is always below the normal speed of the motor, and increase in the speed above normal level is not possible by this method. So obviously when you have the characteristic always in the normal condition, this is your normal condition, your characteristic is falling below the normal. So this method can be utilized only when you want to control the speed below the normal speed. Above the normal speed, it is not possible. Third point, for a given value of variable resistance, the speed reduction is not constant but varies with motor load. Now again, the load plays a very important part, because once the load is changing, what happens? The armature current changes. So load changes, armature current will change. So changing the armature current will again add up to the total resistance, because the resistance of the total sum is equal to the resistance of the armature plus the series resistance, right? Now these armature current changes will further change this resistance, okay? Or otherwise the resistance change the armature current. So this method is used only for small motors. So main disadvantage is there is a power loss. You can control the speed below the normal speed. Above the normal speed is not possible. And it is used for small motors only. So you can't change. And with the load changing, there will be change in the armature current. Now the second method that we are going to discuss is the field flux control method. So first method we have discussed the armature control. Second method is the field flux control method. So for the first motor, that is the shunt motor, your field winding is connected in parallel with the armature. And here, since it is a shunt motor, since it is a field flux control, you are basically controlling the flux. So you are connecting a rheostat not with the armature but with the field, right? Because by varying this rheostat, the field current will change. So once the field current is changing, because speed is proportional to back EMF by flux, so you are controlling this flux to control the speed. So this flux can be controlled by changing the field current. So field current can be controlled with the help of field rheostat. So field rheostat is the one which will be controlling the field current, and then it will control the field flux, so the speed will vary. Now you know that the shunt current is basically the voltage, that is the supply voltage, divided by the sum of the shunt resistance plus the shunt field regulator or the rheostat. Now what is happening? Now if the resistance of the shunt, this resistance is increased, so if you are adding this resistance, obviously the field current will fall, and the flux will fall, because the field current, when it is falling, the flux will fall and the speed of the motor will increase. So motor runs at greater than the normal speed, which was not possible in armature control method. So in armature control method, your motor is always running below the normal speed. But here in a flux control method, you can see that the speed is increasing, means motor is running at a speed more than the normal speed. Now motor is used to correct the fall of the speed because of the load. So you know that when there is an increase in the load, what happens? The speed falls. So the speed falls, you want to increase the speed so that the motor runs at a constant speed. This is possible with the help of field flux control method, because by changing the field, what happens? The speed will increase, and the decrease in the speed due to the load and increase in the speed due to the flux will cancel it each other, and then it will cancel each other and the speed will be constant. So you can see that the relationship between speed torque characteristic, if you see for different RC3, RC2 and RC1, that when increasing the field control resistance or the shunt field regulator, your speed is increasing. So speed will increase. So speed is proportional to back EMF by flux. So we can write speed is proportional to the field current, or speed is proportional to the shunt regulator. So if you increase the shunt regulator, then it will be controlling the field and it will control the flux. So one thing you have to remember in this particular method is that you can control the speed above the normal speed. So once when you require a speed more than the normal speed, you go for field flux control, otherwise you go for armature control method. Now okay, so we'll discuss for series motor. So under the series motor condition, what is there? So series motor, your field winding will be in series with the armature, correct? So what happens is that the diverter resistance or the resistance which is in connected with the help of the series field winding. So this is the series field winding where the flux will be controlled. So you are connecting a diverter. So by using a diverter, what happened? The field current is fall, because the current which is coming directly from the voltage will fall once the diverter is added. So from here the current will flow in this direction and less amount of current will go to the field winding. So the field current will fall, resulting in fall in the field flux, and the speed will increase. So speed is proportional to back EMF by flux. So basically you want to fall the field so that the speed increases, and this can be possible only when your field current falls. So field current can fall only when with the help of a diverter resistance which is connected in parallel with the series field. Now this diverter resistance is basically the tap field control method, because here ampere turn is varied by varying the number of turns in the series field winding. So you can see that there is a diverter resistance where the turns are there in the field which is connected with the voltage. So you are basically falling the field current so that the flux falls. So in this condition, if you see the resistance, so when the resistance is increasing in this direction, then your speed is falling. So on increasing, decreasing the resistance, your speed will increase. So this is the relationship between speed, torque for different diverter resistance that is connected with the field. So we have discussed the field control method, and we will see what are its advantages. So we have seen the disadvantages of the flux armature control method. So let us see for the field flux control method. The method is easy and convenient because you are just changing the diverter resistance to control the speed. Second, shunt field is very small. The power loss in the shunt field is also small. In armature control method, if you remember, there was a heavy power loss. Now here the power loss is less. Method is easy and convenient. Flux cannot be increased beyond its normal values because of the saturation of iron. So you can't increase the flux beyond the saturation level. So that you have to remember. Second, therefore, speed control by flux is limited to the weakening of the field, which gives an increase in the speed. So basically, when you are increasing the speed with the falling of the flux, basically you are weakening the field. You are basically weakening the field. So it is applicable over only to limited range, because if the field is weakened too much, there is a loss of stability. So don't use this field flux control method above the limited range, because if the field becomes too weakened, then there will be a loss of stability. That is the disadvantage of the field flux control method. So we have compared the armature control method and field flux control method. Main point that to be remembered is that armature control method will be used when you want to control the speed below the normal value of the speed, and when you increase the speed above the normal value, go for field flux control method. So generally this method is more easy and convenient, but do not weak the field so much so that there is a loss of stability. Now the third method which is used in the industry is basically controlling the applied voltage. So if you remember, the speed is proportional to V minus IARA by flux. So this is the first method, that is the rheostatic method. This is second method, that is the field control method. And the third method is controlling the applied voltage, which is known as the Ward-Leonard method. Okay, so the speed control by controlling the applied voltage is known as the Ward-Leonard method. So this method is basically used in the industries to control the speed. So you can go and search more deep into the Ward-Leonard method, where you will be using a DC generator and a DC motor in series, and then the supply will be given to the DC generator, because and then what will happen, the load will be driving. So you will be having a motor generator set where the field is being controlled. So this is controlling the applied voltage. So this AC motor, which is using the three phase AC supply, so this voltage is being controlled to control the speed of the DC motor. That is the Ward-Leonard method, and it is not in your syllabus at the BTech level, so this is not being used. It is for the DC drives. So this complete the method of the speed control for the DC motors.